We all know of his impeccable record as British Prime Minister. How was he as a grandfather?
Well, he was a very affectionate. He was charming. He loved his grandchildren. He loved us being around the place, as long as we didn't whistle, which is what he hated, and as long as we didn't interfere with his writing. But apart from that, we had a free run of the place. And of course, he built a paradise at Chartwell, a kind of Garden of Eden. And it was the most wonderful thing to play there in all those streams and rivers and pools and all the great walls he built, and to be with him, but just as a very affectionate grandfather.
Sir Nicholas, you were in your mid-teens when your grandfather, Winston Churchill, passed. Did you, as a young lad, recognize his stature, his place in history?
Well, I don't think I did, really. You see, I grew up at Chartwell from a very young age, from the age of scratch to I went away to school when I was 9. And so I saw him all the time. I saw him every day that he was at Chartwell. And so to me, he was just a very loving grandfather. I don't think it ever occurred to me there was anything more than that. Although I have to say that I went to my youngest brother's christening with my grandfather. And I remember being amazed, age about 4, that there were thousands and thousands of people there who were cheering him. And I wasn't quite sure why.
Your mother, Baroness Soames, Lady Mary Soames, had a front row seat for 20th century history. Unfortunately, she passed not too long ago. What memories were most pronounced for her, having personally witnessed?
Well, I think my mother was the youngest of my grandparents' children. She grew up at Chartwell with my grandparents. Her elder siblings had all, as it were, left the nest. And I think she was probably closest to them of all. And she accompanied my grandfather on many of his trips abroad. She was in the army during the war. She joined up when she was 18 years old and served in the anti-aircraft part of the gunners. And she was regularly accompanied by my grandfather. So she met Eisenhower, Roosevelt, stayed at the White House with the Roosevelts, Stalin, Truman, all these great figures who to us are mere icons, great icons of the earlier days, were familiar territory to her. And she was a very intelligent and clever woman in her own right. And she wrote very clearly about all this. And it was always a source of great pride to hear her talking about it.
50 years ago this weekend, there was an unprecedented outpouring by the British people and for the next several days, culminating with his burial. I think it's safe to say, Sir Nicholas, there was never anything like it prior and there hasn't been anything like it since.
Well, I don't think the rally has. I mean, it was the passing of a man. I mean, I marched in the funeral procession behind the gun carriage, and I remember seeing the faces of thousands and thousands of people literally stricken with grief. I mean, he was a person who had grown up, who they had grown up with, who'd been at their side throughout the war, which was only very recent for many people then. And so I think it was a very somber, dignified, and rather harrowing affair, actually.
He played such a role in crafting his own legacy. I think, for example, of the fact that he wrote a 6-volume series titled The Second World War. 50 years on, would Winston Churchill be satisfied with his legacy?
Well, I hope so. He was not a very vain man. I think he'd be very honored that people remember him in the way they do, and particularly in your country, where memory is cherished. I mean, here, we have to keep alive the memory of Churchill. And part of this weekend and these celebrations this weekend will be to remind people of who he was and what he did.